and Village Schools to order. Roll call, please.
Carrier.
Here.
Iden.
Here.
Jones.
Here.
Mazzer.
Here.
And Wonderly.
Here.
Thank you.
Welcome, visitors. You're really not a visitor.
Exactly.
But we are thankful for all of you being here. Please stand and join me in the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, we think Jerry Hayes may be coming yet, but we're going to skip through that right now because he's not here yet. So let's go to the Finance Committee.
Okay, first off, I just want to say that I think our Finance Committee has, it's helped tremendously. It's helped us work through some issues and, you know, Chad and Denny and Mike and John, I mean, they have a different thought process when it comes to finances. You know, and I don't necessarily know the finance part is necessarily in my wheelhouse. It's not something I necessarily find real interesting, but I have to spend more time on it, you know, because it's part of what we do here. But I think those four have really brought a lot to the board, and I really appreciate it. So thank you, you four. We've met, three or four times now, I think three times. One of our suggestions, and the suggestions of the Finance Committee, and we looked at was the kitchen and, you know, I guess the loss of the money and how do we, you know, bring up revenue a little bit. And typically every year we've been raising the cafeteria meals by about 10 cents a meal. This year, or this upcoming year, the recommendation from the committee would be to raise it by 20 cents. So do you remember how much that would bring it up?
It's $2.95 for, I think, with cake.
So,
but we're still underneath the threshold of what we're reimbursed by the state, which was $3.13, and the other number would be
way under, like $3.60 something.
$3.35 in elementary
for what the actual cost is.
Right.
We're still waiting.
Right. The cost to put that bill out for food and salary and benefits, we're still way under.
Yeah, we're way under, but see, we're picking up some ground. There's
right.
Some change in the staffing in the kitchen, plus that 20 cents. It's going to get us closer to where we need to be in the end. So it's a step in the right direction. We'll continue to look at it. I think they've already looked at supplies and the ordering process, and things seem to be
correct.
Trending
then,
better.
Then Dale and I are going to sit down with the number two. We're going to work on some pricing for the extras and things like that, too.
The other thing we talked a lot about buses, and you know we've been kicking the can down the road, I guess, far too long as far as, you know, purchasing buses, you know, trying to live within our means, but at the same time, the amount of maintenance that we're spending on buses is starting to get higher, you know, year after year. So, and we know it's going to continue unless we do something with it. So our plan and what the recommendation of the committee would be. Would be to look at three new buses this year. We pay for one and a half out of the 18 budget and one and a half out of the 19 budget. So we get three buses, and when would we take possession of those? Would that be in August, all three of them?
You tell me to go ahead. I'll call Dave tomorrow, and he's pretty confident and happy with the beginning of the year.
Okay. And the way it's been budgeted, Melissa's budgeted for a new bus every year. So obviously, this year would be taking a little bit more out. Next year would be taking a little more out. The year after, we would probably skip that one altogether. And then the other thought from the committee, which I think is a great idea, is every year we're going to set $50,000 aside in its own line item. And so then every other year, the money's there, and we're automatically going to go with buying a bus. So it's going to get our older fleet a little bit newer and hopefully keep maintenance costs. And a lot of the safety issues too, you know, it's going to help out a lot there. Did I miss anything, Denny?
I would just like to reiterate what Craig said on just how helpful they are. I've learned a lot, like Craig said, it just makes you look at it in a little bit different point of view and makes you think about things a little differently. Definitely has opened my eyes, and I appreciate greatly appreciate your input and really appreciate that group.
And John made a comment at the meeting, and it's something that's really kind of stuck with me. You know, we're obviously in the deficit spending trend, and, you know, there's things we want. You know, and to me, it's looking at what do we want and what do we need, you know, moving forward. But at the same time, when something comes up that we want and we think it would be beneficial, you know, it's looking at, okay, this is how much money we have. This is how much it's going to cost. Where can we cut from somewhere else for this? So, and I just think that needs to be our mindset moving forward. This is what we got. Instead of increasing things, we need to say, okay, so if Jeff comes to us and he says, hey, I want this, okay, that's a great idea, but where can you reduce from somewhere else in order to save that money? So I think moving forward again, I think that just needs to be kind of our mantra, and we say, okay, you know what, we're supportive of X, Y, and Z, but at the same time, this is what we got, so how are we going to make it work?
Another thing I noticed, I'm super thankful for that committee too. Two finance people that their brains think money, and two people that have been on the school board and are business owners. Wow.
Yeah.
We have a lot to be thankful for.
And our plan is to meet in, 3 to 4 months, and what exactly was the, yeah, well, we're going to look at kind of
short-term, mid-term,
and long-term goals on what we want to do. So we're going to take a break for a little bit, get back together, and come up with that.
One of the suggestions is that state would like us to have an audit committee, but because we have formed this finance committee, that satisfies that need. So we're kind of ahead of what they were going to require us to do anyway. So, but okay, thank you, Craig. Mr. Hayes, we just skipped you, but we would be glad to hear your presentation right now.
Thank you
for being here.
Running a little bit late.
You are fine.
Couldn't because of the rain.
We had plenty to do.
Well, thank you. Tonight came to talk about an application for an Ohio Enterprise Zone agreement. This is to be with Adroit Thinking Incorporated, doing business as 5 Acre Bell. Mr. Becker is enjoying increased business at his site, and he is proposing to add on warehousing and office space. Tim currently is employing 18 persons and is proposing to add 11 additional positions as a result of this expansion. I didn't attach the full pro forma, but on some notes that I did attach, he's looking at between 6,000 to 8,000 square feet, and the facilities part of his project, which is just under $1 million, $992,000 is his project estimate, with $525,000 being in the building itself. So that's the scope of it. And I have attached a estimate at the tax revenue and implications for the school district and for the Great Thinking. You see an asterisk on the left-hand side of my estimate. The actual benefit from any tax exemption for real property is dependent on what that property is appraised at for tax purposes. So I always try to tell, you know, the applicant and the school board, you know, this is just a guesstimate. You can't, you know, rely on this too much. But anyway, if it would come to be appraised at $525,000 market value, you would see approximately what kind of tax revenue that would generate. Back to the application, Mr. Becker said, well, what kind of exemption do you think I should ask for? You see, he wrote maximum possible. One reason you'll see that some of these dates are kind of stale, we were in competition with Indiana for this project. We looked at a couple sites there, but has decided to move ahead here in Ohio. And so that's why you see, you know, December of 17, he actually turned this in. But not until fairly recently was he secure in the idea that was going to happen here. Okay, I just addressed. So according to the Defiance County Commissioner's guidelines, this type of project with this type of job creation, again, 11 new jobs, would qualify for 75% exemption for up to 10 years. So that is what I would like to propose to That is a level at which projects within a municipality would require notice to the school board, not necessarily your expression of support. And so that's the level at which Mr. Becker and I decided to ask for your support at. 75% term, or excuse me, exemption for a term of 10 years.
So these are, these details and stuff that are in you and Jerry are at this point not 100% solidified.
Correct. Yep, this is his application. So we start with the local school, meaning you, and then go to Fort County, give them notification. We would go to Hicksville Township Trustees. He's, that was the other thing. He's right on the border of the village, and he was deciding whether he wanted to annex. So we'll make a stop across the street at the Hicksville Township Trustees to notify them. Then we'll go to Hicksville. Well, we won't have to go to the Village Council since he's not in the village. Then it goes to the Defiance County Commissioners, and they are the ones that give the final approval. So that's right, Keith. These are proposed numbers to me. I've been in business, you know, quite a while. Tim purchased the business from Mr. Steele some years ago, and if you don't know, their business is making wood component parts for companies such as Steelcase. I gave you a whole list of customers that he's picked up. So the reason for the expansion is a good fortune and new customer orders. So my desired action would be acknowledgement. We gave you notice. Of course, you're always entitled to comment to the Township Trustees and, of course, to the County Board of Commissioners. But you're the first stop along the route to possible approval. I met with Keith about a week ago. I wanted to inform the school board that we will, probably next month, I will bring a proposed amendment for the Hillendale Farms Enterprise Zone Agreement. It'd be in the neighborhood of between $6 to $7 million amendment, meaning an increase in their covered property for exemption under a 60% 10-year enterprise zone agreement that we passed in late 2012. And I'll give you the full story on that when I come back. Any questions? Thank you very much. I'll get back to Keith on as far as the signature page and things like that. Thank you.
Okay. Principal reports. Mr. Slattery, would you like to go first?
Thank you. So the 2018 of May principal report here, I'm going to do the past events, and it's been a little bit crazy with the state testing and everything going on, so I'm going to try not to bore you guys too much. State testing is over with, and we're all thankful for that. It was an entire month dominated by logistical nightmares and other issues that the state's put upon us. I'd like to thank all of our one-to-one testing proctors that came in to help all three grade bands. We test all our 504 kids and all our IEP kids one-to-one, and that just really helps us out and really does a nice job keeping our kids at ease and preparing for these tests and, of course, taking the tests. I want to thank all of our group proctors and, of course, our entire testing team. A special thank you to our testing coordinators, Rachel, Mike, and Robin, and, of course, all our teachers for being very supportive and flexible during the testing season. Mr. Countryman and I had the opportunity to go to Fort County Career Center on April 26th to see the National Technical Honor Society banquet. I did not realize at that time I had the pleasure of listening to Mr. Denny Vetter speak on the front stage. It made it even more enjoyable to be there, so I appreciate that, Mr. Vetter. I want to congratulate students Sierra Kerr and Sierra Whitehead for being inducted into the National Technical Honor Society. On April 28th, many of us in here, of course, enjoyed the opportunity to support the Hicksville School Foundation. It's a great event. It's a great opportunity for a lot of people in Hicksville to support our schools and our academic success. On May 5th, we had our junior-senior prom. The kids were great, parents were great, a lot of community support. It's always entertaining to see how many people come out here to see all the kids that are coming in to there's use of your prom cars, you know, dresses, everything. A special thank you to junior class advisors Dale Myers and Lisa Early for putting on that event, and also a thank you to all the parents that volunteered for the post-prom events at Crazy Pins. On May 7th, we had the spring choral concert for grades 5 through 12. That was a great opportunity to attend that in the high school gymnasium. I will say again, I'm starting to learn a little bit more about the arts here, and the gym is not conducive to sound. It's amazing the difference of listening to something in the gymnasium compared to the commons, and the stage was established for that. So, on May 9th, the Hicksville chapter of the National Honor Society inducted 12 new members. Congratulations to all of them. On May 11th, Joy Stevenson and Chris Gagan, they hit up the district art show. They did a great job. See all the kids in grades K through 12 their artwork. Truly, truly special kids in this district. And a special shout out to Ashlyn Metz. If you had the opportunity to see her, charcoal drawing, it was amazing.
I have a picture of it.
Okay. I mean, even the art teachers were saying it's probably one of the best pieces of art they've ever seen from a high school student. It was
added to that, I don't know if you know, but charcoal is very difficult to work with, and to be as clear and precise as what that was, is really
quite. The detail of individual hairs and the eyes, it was insane. On May 14th, the spring band concert. Thank you, Mr. Kohlmeyer, for that event. On May 16th, the second annual Dominion Cup competition with Paulding High School was held here at Hicksville. Our seniors competed against Paulding seniors in academic events and athletic events. It was a great time had by all. Thank you, Margo's Pizza, for helping with the donation of pizzas to us. And of course, thank you to all the parents that donated Gatorade, water, and everything. Our seniors did win the competition, so it was awesome. The kids had a blast, the teachers that were involved. Thank you again for all your support. On May 21st, the winning house celebration, of course, today was a Crazy Pins. We had about 148 kids, I believe, and teachers that went to Crazy Pins today. I stopped over there to check on them. All the kids were having a blast, bowling, laser tag. Congratulations to the House of Satia. Future events, Fort County Career Center Recognition Day is tomorrow. Mr. Cushman and I will be at that. On May 23rd, we'll have our senior barbecue and the senior walkthrough, and that will be our senior's last day at HHS. On May 30th, it will be the student last day of school. That will be a two-hour early release. On May 31st, that's the teacher's last day. And then, of course, on June 3rd, we'll have commencement at 2 p.m. in the high school gymnasium. And tomorrow night's senior awards. I missed one. Thank you. My bad. Try to keep it short. Missed one.
Andy.
All right, I'll try to not touch on too many things, but again, you know, state testing being over was a huge relief. I know in the fifth through eighth grade alone, we read over 250 individual one-on-one tests. So like I said, it's a giant undertaking, it's a logistical nightmare, and we appreciate everyone's time, effort, and support for that. May 10th and 11th, we had the fifth annual Hicksville Shake here. Kind of interesting to put that on for the first time. We had three rounds. Our first round, every student had to go through, and there was something that we tried to trip them up with. And it may be as simple as, did you push your chair back in? Did you thank the judge? We had a secret judge, Ms. Kelly Van Horn, also a photographer, so she was taking some really nice pictures of the kids, and the kids didn't know that she was actually a judge. After that first round was over, we took the top 10 kids, we announced those 10, and we moved on to the hospital where they had to present to a panel of five judges, what they felt like was the biggest problem in Hicksville and their solution to that problem. Those judges narrowed it down to the top five kids, and those five students were Ryland Bassett, Trista Bond, Olivia Clark, Shaylee Miller, and Braden Slattery. Those five kids, in the following day, came and we put them in front of another panel of judges. They answered some questions, some minute-to-minute questions. They had to engage and interact with the judges, kind of work the room, and then we actually took them to the senior center where they worked with our senior citizens for the afternoon. They played cornhole, they kept score, they picked up the bags, they walked around and talked with people who were doing puzzles, just interacted. At the end, we had our judges score those, slide the results into an envelope, which we have sealed, and we will not open until Thursday. We'll announce our winner Thursday. The reason we didn't announce our winner is we have a Defiance County Shake this year. We're taking our top five kids are all going to the county competition, which will take place Wednesday at Defiance College in the morning. And the top five in the county will actually come back Wednesday evening and have an evening ceremony where parents, grandparents, teachers are all invited to. So that's why we didn't want to announce who our winner was prior to announcing. I didn't want a kid to feel like I got third or fourth at Hicksville. Why go try the county here or kill the scourge? So we'll announce our winner to ours during the awards ceremony on Thursday. Our eighth grade students just got back from Washington, D.C. Most of the students in that eighth grade class did make that trip. They were able to go see a lot of really neat things. If you follow them on Facebook, they were at Gettysburg, they were at Arlington National Cemetery. All kinds of memorials they had the opportunity to see. It sounded like it was a great trip, and I heard nothing besides positives on our students' behavior and the way that they represented Hicksville. So, again, very positive for us.
I saw they got to meet Bob Dole while they were there, too. That was pretty neat.
Yes. Yeah. Very good.
And the group of
honor
military people, that was neat.
Yeah, I think that's why Bob Dole was there, by which does he was there kind of
meeting them
there. So the kids kind of got the opportunity to see all of that. Pretty special. We did have the district art show on May 11th. If you guys had a chance to come out, we have some very talented artists. So again, congratulations to Mr. Gagan and Mr. Stevenson for all their hard work for that event. Choir concert for grades 5 through 12 was May the 7th. And again, Mr. Olson, Mr. Colmeyer did a great job. We have some talented musicians. The band concert was May 14th. And again, Mr. Colmeyer put that on in the high school gymnasium. And today was the Satya trip. We had to go to Crazy Bend, like you said. And we got to get Luigi off the slide because we gotta get going. But I'd like to take a trip someday, you know. So congratulations to Satya and all of those students for a good year. Coming up, like I said, the Defiance County Shake is May 23rd at Defiance College. All five of those students will go compete. And summer school information will be mailed home to students who we need to have attended that. So the parents will be receiving something in the mail shortly.
And you did a great job.
Thank you.
Organizing the Hicksville Shake for the first year. And I love the topic.
Thank you. You did a nice job in there. It was tough to.
Yeah, but a great thinking thing, you know. Realistic thinking. It's very good.
And I highly advise that you're careful. Your kids actually do listen to what you talk about at home.
Yes, they
do.
It's
all my kid presented, so.
I had no idea
until that days before. So everybody know that.
Andy, so that competition on Wednesday is during the day, right?
The initial 20 kids is taking place during the day, and then there'll be five that move on from the county, the top five from the county. So we could have four, we could have five, we have done.
Is that open to the public during the day?
I don't believe so. Not during the day.
Not even for me.
Well, for you.
I don't want to miss it.
Yeah, that's during the day is open. We can do that.
And what time is it Wednesday evening?
7 o'clock.
Okay. And that is open to the public.
Yep.
So you can make it. That'd be awesome to be there.
It's at Schaumburg Auditorium.
Okay.
And will we know if any of our kids made it? Will you post that somehow?
I'll try to post it online, definitely.
Okay,
yep.
All right. Thank you.
Okay, Kristen? Well, our music department has definitely stayed busy. I know Mr. Olson, on top of all of the 512 concerts that he and Mr. Colmeyer have been putting on, Thursday, April 12th, the third grade students presented the Granny Awards. Monday, May 7th, we had a Grandparents' Day. For second grade students, so grandparents were invited for a 9:45 show. We had 90 reservations, and then they stayed for lunch, and then he had the evening performance at 6. Tonight we have the fourth grade recorder program going on at 7 o'clock. And tomorrow, the 5th and 6th are going to be performing a talent show at 8:30 for K-4 students. Monday, May 14th, we loaded some buses and took third and fourth grade students who were working so hard with testing to the North Town Cinema in Defiance to go see the Happy Home. Huge thanks to the PTO for supplying the soda this year, so that kids got to watch the movie, get popcorn, and a small soda.
You have the funds for that cake for Christmas?
Yes. Today we did have the Satya House celebration, and just a huge shout out to the students. When we blocked out the points, we decided to do a competition for school supplies for next year, and we put points to some of the bigger items like sketchbooks and earbuds and things like that. Gave them 30, 50 points, and I have to say, Satya did a nice job. I think I put in 1,300 points just on the last day. I thought I was never going to get nine county school supplies, but that was a great thing, and that is actually being donated to Tools for Schools, which is going to be taken over by the community centers. So, amen. May 23rd, on Wednesday, we have our 1-2 awards, grades 1 and 2, in the Commons from 9 to 9:30. Grades 3 and 4 will have their award ceremony from 10:10 to 10:40 in the elementary gym. And then on the last day of school, we are having a 2-hour early dismissal, but our kiddos also get to meet their teacher from 8:30 to 9:15. And then grades K-1 will have their fun in the sun from 9:30 to 10:15. And then grades 2 through 4 will be having their fun in the sun from 10:30 to 11:15. And the PTO has also stepped in to help with this as well. That's just been a great group of individuals that have really shown a lot of support just in this year that they've been moving the PTO back. So that's all I have.
Thank you very much. You guys have been busy. Moore County Report.
Hello, everyone. Good evening. Got quite a bit to go over tonight with the Moore County Report. A lot of good things. As Jeff mentioned, tomorrow there'll be roughly 2,000 people in for the Senior Recognition Day tomorrow. So if anybody's coming, don't get there at quarter till 9 if you want to see. So, with that, one of the students out of the computer networking, and I read out my notes at home by accident, but he won in first place in the state computer networking for Moore County. So that class, that program has constantly put out top students. If I remember right, I think it was 2 years ago, one of them got a full ride at MIT, you know, from out of the program there. So we also did our yearly house tour at the end of the year with the building trades, and it's by far the best project that I've seen them do. It's a beautiful 4-bedroom, 3-car garage home, and it's just really done nice with heat and floor, both instructors said that they just had some of the best students that they ever had come through that program. They were very skilled, and it showed in the house. The house was absolutely beautiful, what they worked on. So I think the open house for that's this Sunday. It's over by Ridgeville. And if anybody wants to see what those high school kids can do to build and put together, it was pretty impressive. You got your carpentry, your plumbing, and your electrical departments, but not do all work in that house.
That just this year, do they?
Yes. They build one every year.
Okay, so I mean, who buys that? How
does
that start?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, there's the interview process that starts from the applicants that will fire up here probably in June or July. And then from that, the department supervisor will, with the building trade instructors, they will interview the people that are applying for this. And then they will, after the interview process, they will select a couple or a person to build the house for. And there's some rules and there's some guidelines that everybody has to agree to. In general, it's been a very smooth process. I think I graduated 37 years ago. They were doing it back then when I did it. So every year they build a home. They started in the fall as soon as school starts. The seniors and the juniors are learning behind them. And by the end of the year, they're all working on it. And it wraps up. They get it done. They go out there every day after they have their academic instruction. They go out there and work on that house all day, from scratch to the finish. They don't lay the carpets and that type of stuff, but they don't do the drywall. All the lumber. I don't think they do, I think the cement is subcontracted out by the homeowner, but they do all, they build all the walls, they build all the rooms, they do all the electrical, they do all the home. So, you know, you figure they're only out there 2 to maybe 3 hours a day. I don't recall what it is for sure, but to be able to put this together, and it's the biggest home they've ever done. They did a great job on it. Just looks beautiful. Full basement underneath, finished.
Where's that located?
It is just east of Ridgeville Corners. And do you know where the, it's just east and a little bit to the south of the VFW Hall, or the Legion Hall there in Ridgeville Corners, probably a couple miles, and then one to the south, 2 or 3 miles. I think this weekend's when they have their open house. But I, you know, I apologize about it. I didn't realize that some of you did not know that they built a house every year.
I think I knew that they did, but I didn't know particulars of how that works. And so they set a price at the beginning?
You know, I don't know the particulars on them and how they do that, but I think the homeowner supplies everything, but just the labor. I don't think there's any donation or anything they do back to the school, but I know it's kind of a trade-off. I can be wrong about that, but I believe it's just a trade-off, the experience for the students, and the homeowners have to be patient too. They know it's going to be a 4-year project.
That's great.
We did our 5-year forecast. School's looking the best it probably has in a long time. We're not deficit spending over the next 5 years. This year's going to be roughly a $700,000 surplus. That 1% mill went into effect that was voted on in the levy that passed. And the school is it's just setting in good financial shape for where it has been at previously over some of the years. We're also laying back $500,000 a year for some capital projects that have to be done at the school, and that's budgeted in the 5-year forecast. For each year is $500K budgeted into that forecast. When I was on the board here, as we discussed, you know, the heating and the air units on top have to be replaced, and that's going to be a big chunk of change. So they got that fund started, and that's all running very smooth. I also want to talk about Mr. Doug Beck. He is the adult ed supervisor over there. The job that he does for that school is it's really hard to explain, and I don't think people realize how big the adult ed department is at Ford County. They are the number one training program for ProMedica for the rescue people.
CEO paramedic?
The paramedics, yes. So they're contracted. They also do outsourcing for even the Hicksville Fire Department, different things they do training for. It's quite a program. They've got a satellite facility, training facility in Toledo also with that. And it's pretty much charged at a break even or a slight profit thing. It's a service that's provided by the career centers. And Mr. Beck has just done an outstanding job in growing the adult ed programs over there. And he is a very busy man. And I think his budget's well worth it. $1 million a year just for the adult program. And the final thing, if I can recall it, the forecast for the student. That pretty well sums it up, I guess. There's something I'm forgetting, but those are the big items. But Ford County is something to be very proud of that we're a part of. They're under very good leadership. Staff is very good, it's just like it is here. So we're doing things outside the box or trying to find new ways to get kids interested. And some of their programs are just outstanding. So I really do feel very fortunate that Hicksville is part of that system. And that it's a good network together between the schools. So.
That's great.
That's it.
Thank you for representing us. Okay.
Superintendent. Yep. Repeat just a couple little things, but I just have to. First of all, I spoke with the representative of ODD to verify that our safety operations plan for our district, elementary and middle school, high school, have successfully been submitted to ODD.
The deadline is actually not until July 1st, but they start sending reminders, how about Jeff, in January, and I think they send it to everybody, because Jeff's always like, have you done this? Do you have to do this? But I had to wait till after the May 16th submission, was when I submitted it last year, so I had to wait till after that to do it. So that is done. In addition to that, this year, they require us to include, which was an easy fix, but I had to include that we are a preschool through 12th grade, because the preschool now has to be, since they're in our building, abides by our safety plan. So they should be compliant now as well. Thanks to Eric for giving me the double set of eyes as we review that every year and make sure that we're accurate. Next year, every 3 years, you have to redo, they told me about it today, signatures and from different people that you have to acquire over that 3 year plan that needs to be done every 3 years. And then that has to be submitted separately starting next year. A big thanks to the School Foundation for their work with the trivia night that they held April 28th. It was a fun night. Everyone there really had a great time, and we really appreciate the teachers, the administrator. We really appreciate everything the foundation does for our school, because they've sponsored a lot of things, over hundreds of thousands of dollars that they sponsored in grants for the teachers. So we wish them continued success. Linda Aycock was here a couple weeks ago. She is a District 1 State Board of Education representative, and she came to make a presentation to the district. We presented this certificate in recognition of exceeding expectations in student growth on the Ohio School Report Cards of the 2016-17 school year. The award was actually given out in November, so we knew about it in November of last fall. But she has been personally delivering these certificates to the schools in her district, which I thought was really nice of her to take the time to come here and do. And she pulled up and she said, oh my gosh, your building's beautiful. I think it might have been raining that day, I'm not sure. But she took a picture outside before she came in, and then she wanted to know if she could go for a tour. So I took her for a tour, and she was impressed with everything that she saw in the building. So congratulations to the students and staff for their hard work to achieve this award. Okay, and it is an award in recognition of exceeding expectations of student growth on the Ohio School Report Cards for the 2016-17 school year. Nice job. Just to reiterate that Chris and Joey, their work with the district art show, that is an impressive, amazing event, and they put a lot of work into that. That's not just something they decided to do, and they spent a couple weeks working hard to do it. It's all year long, and they make sure that every student in the elementary that takes art and every student in the high school, everybody has something that they display at that art show. So a big shout out to them, because that's a great thing. And then the Senior Citizens and Volunteer Banquet was held last Thursday morning. Our kindergarten students did a couple of numbers, and then I spoke to the Senior Citizens and Volunteers about our current safety features that we have inside of our building. So it was a good day. It was nice to have them here. I love that event every year, and I just wish more would come. So I don't know if we're not getting the message out or not, but I mean, I think we had, how many people here, Linda, 75 maybe? But when we first did it, I think it was, oh my gosh, in the old elementary, that thing was packed. I think everybody thought we were going to ask them for something, and they were ready for the fight to begin, but that's not what that senior citizen banquet is for. It has been, and always will be. I mean, that was the 16th year that we've done it. Kevin had me do the first one, but it's to recognize our senior citizens and volunteers and the example and role model that they are for our students over the years. And so it's just to say thank you for being those role models and for being volunteers in our district. So we're grateful to them, and we love to have them come in. And Linda, you had slipped me a note here a little bit ago about we need to vote on the bus purchase. And she thought, Melissa thought it would be a good idea that we do. So
yeah, thank you very much.
Okay, and that is all I have.
I wanted to ask, I was at prom walk-in, and a community member stopped me and just commented how great the look looked. The school looked awesome, and there wasn't a dandelion to be seen anywhere, and just what a great job it looked out there, just how nice it looked, and it was great. So I just love that. I totally agree.
Thank you.
Yes.
May I say something with Mr. Stevenson's class? Tomorrow, I know maybe getting in front of it a little bit, but tomorrow, his class was tasked by, in 2011, Jim and Karen Schmidt started the Hicksville Foundation Fund, Hicksville Community Fund. And so there's different members on the committee, but Mr. Greg Slattery thought of the idea of having the Hicksville Art Department design the slogan and the logo for this. So tomorrow we meet at 11:45 during their lunch break and present the winners of that. And there's a free pizza lunch with that. There's a small prize money that with it too. The applicants, the job that these students did, this all happened within about a 2 week period. They were outstanding. The applicants, so not only is that a Hicksville Community Fund, but the logo and the slogan is going to be from our Hicksville students. And they just did a beautiful job. That's all I have to say about what Mr. Stevens did that. He opened his arms up to it and grabbed hold of it, and it's very nice.
Okay. Anything
else on that? Okay, let's move to the consent agenda. Are there any items that need to be removed?
There's one correction.
Okay.
On page 7, the Aptogee agreement has not expired in June of 2020. It's actually July 2021. So they have the wrong date there. What we're showing there, only reflected in 2 years, and it's 3 years, 2021.
Yep. Anything else? Okay, can I have a motion to approve the consent agenda? Steph, thank you. Second?
I'll second.
Greg, thanks. Okay, roll call please.
Carrier?
Yes.
Aiden?
Yes.
Jones?
Yes.
Mazur?
Yes.
And Wunderlich?
Yes.
Okay, motion passed 5-0. All right. Do I have a motion to approve the minutes and financials? Jen, thanks.
I'll second.
Minutes from the regular board meeting on April 9th, 2018, the special finance committee meeting on April 25th, 2018, the special board meeting on April 26th, 2018, and the special finance committee meeting May 14th, 2018. Treasurer's report.
I have a lot. Okay, just on my treasurer's update, when I turned around and ran my financials for the cafeteria at the end of April, I thought I was going to like fall out of my chair, because we actually were $445.24 to the good. I think the majority of the reason for that was due to the daily sales. Like the daily sales for that month seemed to go up. I'm not exactly sure why, but that was good. And we also received a state subsidy payment during that. We also had some decreased sub wages, and our food costs have gone down, I believe. She's probably kind of using more of what's in her kitchen and trying to get rid of all that before the end of the school year rather than ordering maybe as much. So had that. I also have in your packet workers' comp. I received a quote from both comp management and Shapley regarding our workers' comp premium. My recommendation would be that we just stay with Shapley. I know that they're, I think when I calculated it today, it was like $684 was the difference. But
for
the fiscal year 19. But the good thing with Shapley is that they've done a really good job for us. I mean, we've had our print, well, our issue last year that you know, they helped us with that. And really, comp management is not aware that we have like a $9,900 outstanding claim out there. So I can see, at least with Shapley, I think our claim, like our premiums will probably kind of stay consistent, whereas with Shapley, with that premium, or with, I'm sorry, that claim getting tossed in there, I can see our rates go up anyway. So I think we're just as well off to stay where we're at. So
they know the history we mentioned.
Right.
We talked about it, I think, and I agree with Melissa, so I think we should just stick right with that for now.
Oh, no. In just wanted to let you know that you should be receiving some information, I believe, from the state auditor. I'm not sure who will send it to, but in regards to our, basically like finalizing our financial audit. So, yeah, nothing major, a few little things, but just wanted to let you know that. In regards to, I usually try to put some pie graphs in here for you guys. Basically, everything is pretty much going all right. Our local income tax was up 17.79% from what it was last year, which that's a good thing, kind of unexpected from what I had budgeted last year. Everything has pretty much stayed the same. Just kind of looking here to see if there's anything. We did pay, let's see. Our purchase services, our invoice from the ESC, our final invoice should come here within the next few weeks, and then that will kind of take care of purchase services, hopefully, for the year. We've had some little bit of activity, nothing much. I think the Microman phone payment was something that was that we paid in March, something fairly relevant or fairly new. And other than that, there really hasn't been a lot of activity. We did have in support services, I know that I put it on here this month, our arbitration expenses have really went up for our legal fees. And just a couple of little things in there. Again, that was something with the phone payment. Really not a whole lot going on in there. We just wanted to kind of highlight a few items there. Five-year forecast, that is due here at the end of this month. And I believe I put some information in your packets. And the good thing is, I guess the good thing and the bad thing is, as I was kind of getting ready for this meeting, we have a revision. The first half revision, because it's, and it's pretty good, it is actually showing that we might actually come out about $50,000 cheaper for this fiscal year. And the main reason for that is that if you look at our personnel services, line number 3.010, I've kind of revised this to show you, I guess I'm showing 20,000 to the good. There was a pay, like in fiscal year 2016, we had a 25 pay year. And then in fiscal year 2017, we had a 27 pay year. So if you take those 2 years and you average it out, there's still 26 pays. But when I had done my, kind of like my forecast, I put the numbers in there to reconcile 2017 and didn't even think that we're actually, I was going 2.5% off of what was put in there from fiscal year 17 and did revert it back to a 26 pay year. So we should come in a little less than what I had initially anticipated. So I apologize for that, but I mean, I guess it's all to the, pretty much to the good.
Now, has this been adjusted to show the 140-ish thousand for the bus to come out for this year? And does this include the 60,000 from the land sale going in here?
Yeah.
Oh, that's included in this 20,000?
Yeah.
But we didn't deficit spend.
Oh, we didn't deficit spend. So just to kind of summarize, I mean, there were some items that, you know, were a little better than what we had initially anticipated. I know like our general property taxes did go up a little bit. If you look at my, kind of in my notes that I had provided to all of you, there was a couple reasons. Our valuations did go up a little bit this year than what had initially been anticipated. Not, we weren't going to make a mint off of it, but they did go up a little bit more than what we anticipated. But when I was speaking with our software provider, she had made mention that in the first half of this year, we may have received a little extra percentage-wise as there was a federal tax regulation coming down the pipeline that people that paid it early were going to get a tax break. So they might have, we might have had a little bit of extra revenue in the first, you know what I mean, in February, or, you know, we received it in March or April compared to what we normally would, just because they were trying to take advantage of that tax credit. So we'll have to kind of see where we pan out at the end of next year, but they might be down a little bit, but nothing major. Pretty much everything else has kind of stayed in line. I did adjust our income tax up due to what our cash flow has been this fiscal year, and then just kind of modified that across the board, going up to 1% each year. Our unrestricted grants and aid, I have that for fiscal year 18 and 19, we're still under the same governor's budget, and so we are on the guarantee right now, so that should stay pretty consistent. It does show a little drop in fiscal year 2020, but you never know kind of what the governor's budget will look like. Everything else seems to be pretty much in line. Line number 1.060, that is where that $60,000 land purchase revenue came into play, so I put that amount of money in there. 1.060.
Okay.
So you'll see a little spike there, and then it kind of comes back down. Again, I did adjust down for the personnel services, which is a good thing. Thankful for that. Employee benefits, that's come down a little bit. Nothing significant there either. Purchase services and supplies and materials, I think for the most part, those are staying fairly consistent. Let me see here. I think I said here, starting with fiscal year 2018, moving forward, the district projects a 5 to 6% increase in purchase services from year to year, and supplies and materials.
Either way is fine.
I don't think it doesn't bounce up real fast, but you just kind of see a gradual incline across the board there.
The lack from this year,
yeah.
17, 18, a lot.
Let me look here, I have something.
They had dropped.
It had dropped, and then it kind of went up.
Okay.
Sorry about that. Major contributors, because if you look at like your graph as to kind of where we're going, we did increase like our supplies and materials. We have a lot of bus repairs. We had bus repairs under materials and supplies. We had our building repair supplies had went up. The treasurer's office, we had purchased the new requisitioning software, which was about a $6,000 increase, and fuel. Fuel had increased over the course of this year from last year, so that's kind of where that's projecting going forward.
How much is a payroll?
I'd say it all depends. It kind of depends, but probably around 200. And, 40. I'd say 250,000 a week.
Okay, so
up 2 weeks.
I mean, every 2 weeks.
Okay, so. I was looking at what the finance committee looked at last week, and we were looking at a $252,000 deficit. Now we're positive $20,000. So a payroll's $250,000, so that would break even. Plus we have $60,000 that went in there, so I would think we'd be more than $20,000 in the plus, or I guess with the difference between the other part of the bus. Maybe that's the issue.
Well, I think
I did make a couple little tweaks from when we were sitting at the meeting last week when we were sitting in there.
Yeah,
and I think I also had like a $30,000. I'm not saying we're going to have to transfer money for the cafeteria, but I did put in there like a transfer for the cafeteria.
Okay.
In case we would need it.
Okay, I also see there's like a $300,000 less deficit spending next year compared to.
I didn't look at the rest of it. I mean, I just kind of came across that whole thing with the payroll.
But I mean, how do we go from $710,000 deficit spending next year to $428,000? I mean, that's a huge jump. The following year we go from $904,000 from projected last week to $1.276.
Just on this year on payroll.
No, I'm talking about the bottom line down here. You know, we're talking about this year we're going to be $20,000 in the plus. Next year we're going to deficit spend $428,000. But last week when we went over this, we were expecting the deficit spend $710,000. I guess I'm curious. I mean, that's a huge drop. What changed from last week to this week?
What line number are you looking at?
I'm looking at 6.01.
When the personnel service went down, it also shows a slight decrease in your employee benefits, a little bit. Everything else seems to be right there. But your number up above, like your total revenue is 2.08.
Yeah.
That's the same. The only difference here is the personnel services has dropped.
I guess, you know, when I look at this, my main thing that I look at, number one, is that line right there.
But if you look at the detail up above, the only things that have changed were just those two line items, personnel services and then employee benefits.
Okay. So what dropped 2019 fiscal year?
That's what I'm saying. That's what dropped. Those two line items dropped.
Okay.
What two line items?
I guess we're looking at
3.01 and 3.02.
So the 3.01 where we were at 6.1 million, 6.3 million, 6.36 million last week, and now we're at 6.1.
Right, because of that decrease there for this fiscal year. So it kind of...
Well, yeah, I understand that affects this year.
But it also projects it going forward. If you see those numbers across the personnel services, they've all been adjusted down.
I guess I'm not, I think I see what you're saying,
because
you had this too
this
high.
And then, yes, and then so it adjusts this across the board. Same thing with like that.
Just
the
first one to have
an
effect on the other 4 years.
Well, yeah, but I mean, I guess the thing is when you project this year at one too many payments as far as because there's 27 payrolls as
right.
opposed to 26. So next year, is there 26 or is there
26?
26. Mm-hmm. So I guess I don't know how this line would affect that line. You know,
because we're in the hole as much to start the next year.
Because it's taking a calculation and it's saying, okay, just take the percentage.
Starting the year with a positive instead of a negative. So that would affect what your end game is because you didn't start out in the same hole. We need to start 2019 in a different place than we.
Yeah, I don't think
but
that.
But this is a 3%. This is a 3%. This is a 3.46% increase from the year before. Okay, so this is projecting this going forward that it's going to still increase, but not as dramatically.
So you took the 3. Whatever percent on the top of 5.9, and now you're taking, I'm sorry, not the 5.9 really was last week.
Right. It was 6.1.
So you took the 3.4 from 6.1. Okay.
So as it goes forward, it just kind of projects that across the same way. I want to take a look. Like I said, I found this like real late here tonight as I was preparing, and I just went,
can we improve this tonight? I mean, really, I mean, what else are there other concerns in here? I mean, we're approving this to go to the state. Are we comfortable that this is correct when from last week to this week it's changed from this evening, you know, earlier today to now it's changed?
That's why I even told you, I was like,
I'm not particular line correct. She brought that to my attention at 5:30, and I said, I think you need to print that new page.
Definitely.
I mean, you know.
I guess
an hour ago.
Are we sure everything else is correct?
I'm not going to say it's spot on because it's a budget.
Yeah.
You know, but I do.
I spent quite a bit of time looking over all the previous ones. How have you looked back at? Like you provided October 2016, May 2017. How accurate do you feel these were to what it is now?
I think based on the simulations I know because there was forecast I gave it when, like last May, I was so stressed out, my eye was twitching. I mean, I was in a panic myself. I do think that based on the simulation I had from the state, income tax was down from what it had been in the past. Do I feel like these are accurate numbers? I think they're pretty fair numbers. I think that
have
they're
looked back and compared how accurate the previous ones were to say, oh no, line 3.45 was 500% off, what was wrong?
Yes, but
at, every time we look at them, they're always going forward. It doesn't seem like we've looked at them and looked back.
But I think at the last finance committee meeting, I did provide a spreadsheet in which it was, I mean, because really the only year that I have to compare to would be fiscal year 17. To say that's a pipeline, I can't, I mean, I've only had one. And that wasn't my, you know what I mean, but like that, I've had one. To say, like, here's our actual numbers compared to what was projected. I have one, and I can provide that to you. I think at the meeting last week, I think it was part of that. I think it was actually in your packet for that. You have to look. If you don't have it, I can get it for you. But do I feel, Craig, do I feel like these numbers are in the ballpark? Yeah, I do.
I mean, I thought they were in the ballpark last week too,
well,
but you know.
But like I said, everything else is kind of staying the same. The only thing, like I said, it's given me fits. I've sat and fretted about it. Just by chance, I'm going through things, and all of a sudden, it just like dawned on me that I had 27 pays. I was estimating 27 pays instead of the 26.
Yeah,
not
every 5 years.
Yeah. And so. I'm understanding you just forgot to take
pull
that
it out.
Back. Because you don't, you'd already put it in that one projection. Mm-hmm. Okay, and automatically.
Yeah, and then it automatically feeds.
And then you didn't change it.
And right. Jump in on the other. Right. Yes. Right.
And I did. That was.
I like it.
Yeah, we don't. It is confusing when that happens.
And I know that there's a way around it.
You have to work X number of days before you can be paid. So like every 5 years, the teachers miss a paycheck. There's a 3 week lag instead of a 2 week lag because of you have to teach so many days before you can be paid. So then it sets up that 25-27 mm-hmm. thing.
Right, and it's only over so many years. So yeah. that was my fault.
We wish it was never because it was tough
it
to
becomes,
explain too.
You have to teach about 25 years before you
figure
it out.
Well, people think that you're not paying them properly.
They think they work the week for free.
Well, the numbers always work out. They just don't fall conveniently.
Right, right.
And the sooner in October you let them know it's going to happen in August, the smarter you are.
So. Other than that, we've had, we do have in our capital outlay, I appropriated for a bus, for purchase of the three buses, with paying $142.5 out of the fiscal year 18, $142.5 out of fiscal year 19, not purchasing a bus then in fiscal year 20, and then kind of getting on the rotation of purchasing a bus every other year.
So did we go with the 50,000 then, like for 21 and 22,
I
or
did
we go with the whole?
No,
you know
I appropriate. I took out 50,000.
Okay.
Out of
21 and 22.
Out of 19, 20, there's no bus at all. There's a number there, but that is for like other capital equipment.
But how much did we take out for 19 then?
Fiscal year 19 is.
Not because we're buying a bus.
It's 92. I think it's 92.8.
Well, we're spending 142 in 18 and 142 in 19. And that 20 would be zero. 21 should be 50,000.
Mm-hmm.
22 should be 50,000.
Right.
Is that the way we got it figured out? Okay.
Yeah. And then
Melissa, where is that? I know we were going to establish a line item for that. Or where does that fall under? Where we're putting the $50,000 for the bus?
It's going to come out of PI.
I think she means what fund we put it in.
We're going to make a line item for that, right?
I think you showed me an account that was being used.
It's still within the general fund.
Right.
So,
right.
We
so she will put that money in that account.
Okay.
Or label it to that
yes.
account.
And at the next board meeting, I'll be sure that we kind of reactivate
yes.
that.
Yes.
And then, so So you want her to put that $50,000 in?
Well.
Not next year, but we're.
It wouldn't be next year.
So you start with this for your 20, right?
I think we need to back up real quick. So fiscal year 18 and 19, those are the 2 years we're splitting the 142.
25, right.
Okay, so I guess I want to back up real quick, because we talked that a payroll's 250-ish grand. So that gets us, well, I already closed that out last week, so that gets us down to zero. And then we had $60,000 that went in for the property, so which I would think we would be at $60,000 and not $20,000.
Minus 30 for.
Hang on real quick. Then what we had talked about in the financial committee was taking out $50,000 out of PI for bus in 18, $50,000 out of there, so basically it would be a button, you know, 90-ish thousand. I'm thinking that $20,000, what were you saying about $30,000? You were getting ready to, because you wouldn't take $142,000 in a year.
$30,000, if you're looking at your number down, you're thinking 60 here, take $30,000 out, because I didn't know if we would have to transfer money to the cafeteria.
Okay. Does this number include, because if we're going to, if we're not taking $142,000 out of this 2018, we're actually going to take 90-ish or so, and then we're going to transfer 50 from PI.
Right.
So I don't necessarily know that this is showing it on 2018, 2019.
Well, you have to think that 2018, we had the purchase of a van, we had the purchase of a Malibu, we had, and then we're going to purchase some buses. We also had some other things in there.
I'm just going off the 250 in the negative we were last week, and I'm trying to figure out how we went from negative 250.
Okay, but you.
To $20,000. I think it would be higher than that $50,000. I think, higher than the $20,000. Because, okay, so we're $250,000 in the negative, we skip a payroll, so now we're at zero, we're flat even. So based on what was last week to this week, so we're flat even. So now we take $50,000 out of PI to pay for part of the bus, goes in here, now you're at $50,000 in the plus. Then you take $60,000 from the land sale and you put it in that budget. So I'm showing I would think that we should be at $110,000 in the plus.
I don't think we're taking $50,000 out of PI this year.
I think that's what we talked about, was $50,000.
Not this year, not this year.
Okay.
Next fiscal year.
I didn't get that, that was correct.
Okay, was that wrong, Danny?
Sorry, I was looking at something.
Next fiscal year, we're not buying, we're not on the schedule to buy textbooks. Next fiscal year.
I remember you saying, yep, I remember that. So that's, okay, so the $50,000 for 18 was buying textbooks, next year we're not buying, so then we're going to put it towards the bus next year then.
I didn't catch that, we're doing it this year.
Okay, I guess I took, well, how much do you have in PI right now?
Because when we want to take it out of PI, we can't.
Yeah, well, that's.
Right, Melissa?
Yeah, I need to try to see like what our flow is, and then try to budget that one. You know what I mean, so that we're spending what our income is.
Yeah, I mean, I know we don't want to make our PI fund too, you know, too anemic, but yeah.
Well, that usually, historically, if I'm not mistaken, Craig, if I think back over the years, even back when I was a principal, that PI account pretty much gets exhausted in a year.
I believe that, yeah.
Either we used it for the Apple lease, I think, lots of times, for buses, lots of times, obviously for textbooks, we've used it for that. So I think the PI account is pretty much exhausted every year. Or should be, because it collect, it's easy to predict, because you know how much you're going to collect each year.
Right, so like right now, I have $122,000 sitting there.
Okay, the rest of this year, and you're going to get another $180,000 next year?
Next year. Well, you don't collect until like, so you.
September, October-ish time.
Oh, yeah, September.
So my suggestion, I'm not the treasurer, I remember, I would think that we get to the end of the year, when we see what's left in that PI account, whatever amount's in there, that's what I'd use moving forward for the bus.
You mean at the end of the 2018 fiscal year, right?
About in another month.
Yes.
Yeah.
I mean, if there's a hundred and some thousand in it now, do we expect any to go out between now and, you know?
Well, there probably is some, but then again, I mean, that, either way, it would just have more.
For next year.
Understand.
But I mean, I think taking out, I mean, it's still the district's money. Whether you call it PI or general fund money, it's still basically it's the same pot.
Yeah, I mean, it's a little more restrictive only.
Right, you can, not sure.
Right, right. That's where the stipulations I think are, correct. So I mean, certainly we'd want to exhaust that on things like buses and, you know, you can use PI money for. Yeah, great. That's been the story. Which then would have an effect on what she's predicting for the following year. So it is a prediction. You know, I've always, to be honest, I never look at years 3, 4, and 5.
Well, I know, but I'm
just too scary.
I'm not looking at 3, 4, and 5. I'm concerned with 1 and 2 right now. I'm concerned with what's right now and next year.
And I think with what she found today, I think the 20,000 to the good, to me, in my mind, that made sense because of that payroll that she had forgotten about. So I said, yeah, I think you should adjust that for that page out differently for them. From this year on, I can't see.
Right.
I
think
one request.
Thank yeah, it's just how they print off the software. I know, that's why I mark October and stuff online too, because they all look the same.
Okay, anything else?
I guess, Craig, you know, you were concerned on whether or not we should approve it. When I look at this, from what I've seen over the years, I think it's a lot more in line now than it was last night.
Yeah,
I'll say that.
I would
agree with that.
So, I mean, it doesn't scare me as much. I mean, we're looking at deficit spending of $420,000 next year, $28,000, and you know, I think if the treasurer can get within the $200,000 range, I think that's pretty fair when you're talking $12 million. So if she's predicting 428 deficit spending and it only ends up being 200 and some thousand deficit spending, I can live with that. I think that's really pretty good prediction, in my opinion. Okay. If it's a lot more than that, then, you know, like last year's was, but we, you know, she found some errors that were made, so it all worked out. But.
And you know, you try to base them off what you also see. You know what I mean? The trend for the income tax, because I was asking, you know, the board, do you feel as if the income tax seems fair? Do you feel as if it seems like it's coming in the way it should? Everybody thought, you know what I mean? So I had kind of decreased my, what I thought we were going to bring in for income tax. The scenario that I saw for the governor's budget was that we were going to lose $215,000 off the top. You remember me with that? I was predicting what the information that I was given at the time, and then in June rolled around and the governor's budget changed. And we were also moved from the cap when we got moved off to the guarantee, so that made a huge impact for us.
And to top all that off, then you also had that people had made quarterly estimates, mm-hmm. and had made them too high, and we had to refund money. It kind of hit her, I think, some of that stuff, I think, kind of hit her on some of that stuff.
Anybody have any questions?
The discussion, okay. That's what we're supposed to do. Okay. Accept the following donations: $250 from the Wholesale House for Girls Basketball, $500 from Tiz Crowley for scholarship in memory of Tim Dotts, $1,000 from the Ohio State Eagles Charity Fund for the Basketball 10,000 Shot Club. Any discussion on any of those? Okay, roll call please.
Carrier?
Yes.
Iden?
Yes.
Jones?
Yes.
Mazur?
Yes.
And Wunderlich?
Yes.
Motion passed, 5-0. We need a motion to approve the following fund.
I'll move.
Okay, thanks.
I'll second.
Jared, thanks. Recommend to approve the following fund.
300-9056, basketball, 10,000 shot club. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Carrier?
Yes.
Iden?
Yes.
Jones?
Yes.
Mazzer?
Yes.
And Wonderly?
Yes.
Motion passed, 5-0. A motion to approve the 5-year forecast. Jen, thanks.
Second.
Jared, thanks. Recommend to approve the 5-year forecast for the May 2018 submission to the Ohio Department of Education as presented. Any further discussion? Okay, roll call, please.
Carrier?
Yes.
Iden?
Yes.
Jones?
Yes.
Mazzer?
Yes.
Wonderly?
Yes.
Motion passed, 5-0. A motion to approve the employment of certified staff. Thanks, Jared.
Yes.
Thanks, Doug. Recommend to rescind a 3-year limited teaching contract issued to Emily Reese at the April 9th, 2018 board meeting. Recommend to non-renew the following contracts at the conclusion of 2017-18 school year. Miranda Decatur, Kate Haggerty, Jay Mast, Amanda Williamson. Recommend to non-renew all certified supplemental contracts at the conclusion of the 2017-18 school year or at the end of the activity. Recommend issuing a continuing contract to Emily Reese beginning with the 2018-19 school year upon fulfilling requirements to obtain continuing contract status. Any transcripts. Recommend to approve the following supplemental contracts for the 2018-19 school year, pending certification and background check. Jamie Altman, co-Mini Aces cross-country coach. Mike Altman, junior high boys basketball assistant coach. Dave Blue, boys basketball assistant coach. Josh Fries, head girls basketball coach. AJ Clausing, head junior high boys basketball coach. AJ Clausing, Mini Aces football coach. Rachel Mann, junior high girls basketball assistant coach. Brian Meiser, girls basketball assistant coach. Paul Payne, co-Mini Aces cross-country coach. Tony Tier, head boys basketball coach. Tony Tier, Mini Aces basketball coach. Recommend to approve the following as substitute teachers for the 2018-19 school year, pending certification and background check. Ed Foster, John Michael, Paul Obermeyer, Paul Payne, Angie Provines, Macy Weatherhead, Kevin Snyder, Rick Straley, Sue Strubing, Nancy Swift, Jackie Underwood. Recommend to approve the employment of substitute teachers from the NWOESC list for the 2018-19 school year. This includes any addendums to the original list as the year progresses.
I'm sorry, did I just move that thing with Paul's names to Pam's?
Oh, Pam. I read Paul too much. Paul Obermeyer, Pam. Pam.
Oh, I heard that also.
Paul doesn't want a sub on top of teaching. No. Thank you.
I have a couple of comments.
Thanks.
So on page 3, the non-renewing of those contracts, those are title people, it's just a 1-year contract. It depends on our title funding each year and whether or not they get to do that. And on the next page, the issuing of the continuing contract to Emily Reese, pending the transcript. We have the transcript, but we haven't done a review process, which that's why I said it.
Okay. Any other discussion? Roll call, please.
Carrier?
Yes.
Iden?
Yes.
Jones?
Yes.
Mazzer?
Yes.
Wonderly?
Yes.
Motion passed, 5-0. A motion to approve the employment of classified staff.
So moved.
Staff? Jen? Thanks. Recommend to non-renew all classified supplemental contracts at the conclusion of the 2017-18 school year or at the end of the activity. Recommend to approve Sophie Clark as a high school office helper for the summer of 2018 for a maximum of 30 hours at minimum wage. Recommend to approve Sydney Slattery as an elementary school office helper for the summer of 2018 for a maximum of 30 hours at minimum wage. Recommend issuing a 2-year contract to Elizabeth Knight as custodian, 8 hours per day, with 1-year experience, beginning with the 2018-19 school year and ending at the conclusion of the 2019-20 school year. Recommend to approve the following supplemental contracts for the 2018-19 school year, pending certification and background check. John Deal, freshman boys basketball coach. Kara Johns, Mini Aces girls basketball coach. Lori Schrader, head junior high girls basketball coach. Jamie Slattery, Mini Aces volleyball coach. Recommend to approve the following as classified substitutes for the 2018-19 school year. Heather Adams, Becky Bailey, Mike Bailey, Jennifer Bergman, Ed Foster, Angie Johnson, Pam Payne, Macy Weatherhead, Paula Scranton, John Smith, Annie Sternheim, Rick Strigley, Sue Strubing, Nancy Swift, Carrie Bowles. Recommend to approve the employment of classified substitutes from the NWOESC list for the 2018-19 school year. This includes any addendums to the original list as the year progresses. Recommend to approve the following as volunteers for the 2018-19 school year pending certification and background check. Bob Weatherhead, girls basketball. Clark Zarman, girls basketball. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Carrier?
Yes.
Hyman?
Yes.
Jones?
Yes.
Mather?
Yes.
Kim Underly?
Yes.
Motion carried, 5-0. I need a motion to approve the services and agreements.
I'll move.
I'll second.
Recommend to approve a mentor program service agreement with Northwest Ohio Educational Service Center for the 2018-19 school year. Recommend to approve resolution to continue membership in the Ohio High School Athletic Association for the 2018-19 school year. Recommend to approve a service agreement with Defiance County Board of Developmental Disabilities to provide educational services from August 2018 to June 2019. The district will be assessed $3,000 per student for the excess cost. Recommend to approve a service agreement with Central Ohio Medical Review, LLC, for the purpose of the district procuring the medical review services and related therapy referrals for students who are undergoing evaluation for or receiving any of the related services of occupational, physical, or speech and language therapies, or audiology services as a component of their IEP service plan. The term of the agreement shall be for 1 year, commencing July 1st, 2018, and ending June 30th, 2019. The cost of said services will be $25 per medical review or referral for students with a single therapy, $50 per medical review or referral for students with two therapies, $75 per medical review or referral for students with three therapies. Recommend to approve a clinical affiliation agreement with Northwest State Community College for early childhood paraprofessional programs beginning August 1st, 2018 and ending July 31st, 2020. Is that right? 2019?
The next one.
But that one is correct. 18 to 20. Okay. Recommend to approve a 3-year software and service agreement with Aptigy at a cost of $25,800. This agreement will expire in June of 2021.
July of 2021.
Okay, any discussion?
This Aptigy, I'm sorry, because my internet's not working. We couldn't open the.
You couldn't get an update.
And so. Because I
couldn't
get it, so I can just.
Yeah, it is an app and a website development company. The app, the biggest feature of the app, one of the biggest features of the app, Steph, is that it has a, what do they call that? It's a one touch, kind of special name for it, you know, offhand. But it feeds out to the entire district, to Facebook, Twitter, the website. It'll send the text message, the email, the instant alerts, everything with a push of just one button, as opposed to logging on to each one of those separate accounts. So it's going to save a huge amount of time for the district. And the cost for all of it, I have covered it, but that was in my explanation that I had sent.
Yeah, I've gotten this and I went through that. That's why I just wanted to hear that. Because my comment on that was,
I looked at it a couple years ago. At that point, I couldn't justify it because we had done the website a couple years before that, and that I couldn't justify spending the money. Our current website is awesome, but this app, this phone app that they're developing, integrates with the website that they're going. don't have the capabilities of doing that with our current website because that service is not available through there. The biggest feature of this is the handheld phone app. It'll be accessible for Android, iPhone.
Yes.
It'll be a great communication tool for the parents and students.
Yeah, I mean, I get the communication there. Yes. That was my question. Is it working with?
Yeah, I believe it is.
Obviously, you wouldn't put it there.
No, I do believe it is. I think it's a great thing. And I think now that enough time has passed, because typically that $6,500 yearly cost is pretty much the standard rate for all these people to develop your websites and stuff. And our website had no yearly expense. One-time fee, but when I looked at this, I couldn't justify doing it then because it hadn't been long enough. Now it's been 4 years, and if we would have been paying, it would have been a lot more than what we paid for our original website, so I think it's justified.
What service are we now anyway, and how much was it?
$6,200, which would be the Omnibus company.
And that's per year?
It was per year, $6,200 a year. I eliminated that. So that covers the $6,500 a year for this.
That's just a set fee.
Yeah. And that's a one-time fee.
So it's pretty much an even wash for the most part.
It is. Now, the amount, the 25-8, saves the district $3,000 by doing it 3 years. So I talked to Melissa about that, which now looking to find your forecast, all worked out great. But put half of it in June, we're going to, and the other half will be when it goes live on August 1st. And then we split between 2 years and save the district $3,000 over the course of 3 years. So we won't have another payment again until July 2021.
Just out of curiosity, on Facebook, I saw that there was, it looked different. It was the weekly shout outs, mm-hmm. and it was in a different format. Was that something to do with this?
No.
No? Okay.
That was Emily Reese. She took it over for a week. The Justice Chamberlain was on the Washington, D.C. trip.
It was pretty
and
cool.
It's kind
like
of funny because I actually sent her an email this week and I said, that looked really professional. It was very nice. How did you do that?
Poor Mr. Chamberlain.
I know you're sitting there. It's like, it's an awesome weekly opportunity for us to give shout outs to our teachers and staff. But it's so funny how many people have said that, so I apologize.
We're always
looking to improve. Remember that.
That's right. She's
like
a little bit more creative than that.
Yeah.
You have to give
away.
I want to say on behalf of Mrs. Chamberlain's behalf that I'm glad you brought that up, Craig, because Mrs. Chamberlain has done that for a couple of years at least, not only the shout-outs every Friday, but she organizes and usually sends most of them herself and gets a few people to help her out throughout the year of sending that encouraging message that she sends out every Sunday night or Monday morning. And I've written my article in the newspaper a couple times about it over the years, but it's because of that lady right there that happens every week, and it is a wonderful thing. It really is. You think about the things that she mentions in that encouraging thing, and the messages she sends out every week, and then the shout-outs. But it's like when a teacher goes to professional development event. We've always said if you come back with one thing, and you've learned one thing from it, then it was worth the event. If one person is a more positive person or feels better about themselves for that week, it's all worth it. So,
it's a great way to end our week and start our week every single week.
Yeah, I like seeing them.
Yeah. You guys get them?
Yeah, I love them.
Yeah, they're nice, aren't they?
Yeah, very much so.
Just to toss an idea out there with the shout outs, if you could, I don't know if you do this or not, but at the beginning of the week or at the end of the week, put them up on the screens in the school so all the kids can see that all the babies in it too.
Okay. That cover everything?
Any other discussion? Okay, roll call please.
Carrier?
Yes.
Guinan?
Yes.
Jones?
Yes.
Mazur?
Yes.
And Wonderly?
Yes.
Okay, I need a motion to approve other business.
A second.
Jen? Steph, thank you. Recommend to approve expenses paid out of the elementary and high school drama fund, including stipends, for the 2017-18 and 2018-19 school year. Recommend to approve the 2018 list of graduates pending completion of all requirements. Recommend to approve the safety operations plan for the school district. Recommend to approve the boys' basketball team to attend an overnight trip to Bluffton, Ohio from June 12, 2018 to June 13, 2018 for a basketball shootout. Recommend to approve the girls' basketball team to attend an overnight trip to Kalamazoo, Michigan from June 22 to June 24, 2018 for a team camp. Recommend to approve the volleyball team to attend an overnight trip to Mason, Ohio from July 12 to July 14, 2018 for a team camp. Recommend to approve the middle school, high school athletic code handbook for the 2018-19 school year. Recommend to approve the activity advisor and coach handbook for the 2018-19 school year. Any discussion?
What is that first one? I'm sorry, don't you want to explain what that high school drama
company? Because, many times the directors have, I know I did this too back then, that, you might have somebody that ran the lines or did certain things, and it's been a lot of times, so you give them a couple hundred bucks out of the drama fund account, not out of the general fund, out of the drama fund account. Now we need to have that approved, so if they're an employee. So this is approving that all those things can be paid for out of those accounts without having to get each little one approved.
It's generally not something,
Right. It is a new thing. The attorney said if we do this every year, we don't have to approve each little thing throughout the year.
Gotcha.
That's for this alone. Sure.
Okay. Any others? Okay. Roll call, please.
Carrier.
Yes.
Iden.
Yes.
Jones.
Yes.
Mazur.
Yes.
And Wonderly.
Yes.
Motion passed 5-0. Recommend to approve, I need a motion to approve the drug testing policy. Steph? Jen? Recommend to approve a drug testing policy for the 2018-19 school year. This policy applies to all student athletes in grades 9 to 12. Any discussion?
Well, my understanding when we were discussing this is that if it works, we might open it up.
Right.
Broaden the spectrum.
Yes. We want to start a little smaller, get the process nailed down, and then possibly expand it.
And the hope, of course, is that deterrence. Yes, it will be a deterrent for the kids. Because sports are important to a lot of the kids, regardless of your going to a lot of adults or not.
So, one question I've been asking. Do we also use the Sheriff's Department dog?
It's not part of the drug policy, no.
Right, but do we use that randomly in addition to this policy?
Well, we have in the past. I would like to do it more often, but number one, it's getting them here is one thing. Also, if we would do it, my understanding is they couldn't do the entire building. They can't do the entire parking lot. If we can get a random dog here occasionally, they can do maybe 30 cars.
And it can only go about 10, 15 minutes to get tired.
Yes.
They get tired real quick.
We did it last year, and we had to coordinate multiple counties and along with our local. It was quite a, I think it took us like 8 weeks to actually get all those schedules coordinated to come in. We did it last year. There was probably 8 dogs, 9 dogs here to do it.
I know to build on this, and Mr. Hall and I are on the same page, and I know when I first started here, those of you on the board, this came up, and I said, no, I don't want to just do the athletes. I want to do as many people as possible, and then we noticed a greater need to get it started, and as Mr. Hall said, let's start with this group and move forward from there. We actually had our college conference students, they did a survey and a presentation recently on drug use and Hicksville High School compared, to what the national statistics are, stuff like that. And they asked me to sit in on it. And I will say that the numbers, in my opinion, were actually, they were good, but you're scared going in there thinking that the number is going to be outrageous and it's going to be, you're going to be shocked. But I wasn't shocked by any of the numbers. I wasn't shocked by any of the usage pieces. But what did surprise me was our kids recognize that some kids have problems in the school, and they said, you know, number one, they want to throw policy to help our athletes say no, but number two, they want more kids tested because they even said a lot of the drugs in the school aren't coming from the athletes. They want everybody tested. They want the drug dogs in the school. They want to see more compliance with drug testing for anyone who attends Hicksville. I thought that was quite surprising.
Yeah, and I got same feedback. Kids been talking about it, which I thought would be negative stuff, but they're for this.
You know, in a way, you would be surprised that when you look at the larger social issues right now, especially with the opioid epidemic and being in the news as prevalently as it is, I don't think it's a shock that the kids are saying, hey, we need to do what we can to help alleviate these issues.
Are we still thinking it's going to be around that $7,000 a year for drug tests?
We're starting on $6,000 to $8,000.
I'm sorry?
$6,000 to $8,000.
$6,000 to $8,000. Have we talked about how much that's going to come out of the athletic fund versus the operating fund? I know it got brought up on, I think, the last meeting when we first talked about potentially some of that coming out of there. Is that feasible? Is that something we can do? I mean, it's a chunky change. I think it's worthwhile. I think it's a good thing.
But going back to what you said at the beginning of the meeting, if we're spending money on money, are you aware of where we're going? You know, we only have one class program. So, you know, are we?
I'm okay with approving this, but maybe we could have some more discussion on specifically. You know, I know one of our topics for the work session is athletic fund, to kind of talk about that, and maybe we could implement this into that, and maybe whether Jeff stays for that, or we talk about it moving forward, having a discussion. I'd like to get in deep into the athletic fund. I'm kind of curious how it's funded, how all that works, and if it's something that can come out of the athletic fund, great. If it can, it can. But I'd like to have that discussion.
Can I comment on this real quick? I think the idea that we're going to accept the drug testing policy, and I'm not trying to separate the two because we still have to know where the funds are going to come from, but it's something that we need to, you know, make a decision on because it's going to be June next week and all these kids are leaving, you know, staff's leaving. We're going to take probably a month work with CMH getting, you know, the logistics of how we're going to test all these fall athletes because school's not in session. Last week of July, all these, and we're going to have 130 high school athletes probably, you know, potentially in July, early August, and we've got to coordinate somehow we're going to do this. So,
I don't think that's the intent.
I'm fine with approving it now.
We just need to decide by August when we start getting that bill where it's going to be paid from.
Okay. Yeah. I appreciate that. I know Mr. Hall does, and I think most of the coaches and the kids do too. So,
not trying to drain your fund.
But your fund is not self-sufficient. Does the general budget feed into your fund, athletic fund?
It hasn't. Well,
it's helped with certain projects.
Yes.
Over time, I think.
Yes. The operation paying for official building equipment. We're fairly self-sufficient. Can you say, Melissa?
Yeah.
When it comes to bigger projects.
Bigger projects, improvements, yeah, the athletic budget can't handle that. How much can we handle for drug testing again? We've been forced in the last few years, football playoffs, basketball regionals, that's extra income.
Yes.
You can't count on that. So, yeah, we can certainly have that discussion.
All right, any other discussion? Okay, roll call please.
Carrier?
Yes.
Iden?
Yes.
Jones?
Yes.
Mazur?
Yes.
Cylinderly?
Yes.
Okay. The drug testing policy passes 5-0. Okay. Now where do we want to go to vote about buses? Do you want to put that down before we go to vote business?
Yeah.
Okay. I need to have a motion that we would purchase 3 buses with half of the payment out of 2018 and half of the payment coming out of 2019. And authorizing Keith to go ahead and make that purchase. Jen's okay. All right. Jen makes the motion. Steph seconds. Any other discussion about the bus purchase?
some of them may be designed, you know, just like, you know, like IndyCar, NASCAR, to kind of break it up to help with, so I don't know how that plays into it.
All right, any other discussion? All right, roll call.
Carrier.
Yes.
Iden.
Yes.
Jones.
Yes.
Mazzer.
Yes.
Wonderly.
Yes.
Okay, passed 5-0 that we'll purchase 3 buses. All right, we move to old business. I asked Keith to share the employment details for the assistant director of operations position that we created.
Hello.
The special meeting, yes.
Right. That was the creation of for Adam, John Adam. Eric was here the month before the regular meeting and had submitted a proposal on what savings that would mean for the district actually by creating that job. And that would be because a lot of the projects that are typically done by contractors, for example, the servicing of all of our heat pumps units, John can do that now. We still have to buy the filters, of course, but he can check the amps and make sure that they're all servicing properly, which was typically an $11,000 cost to the district, $5,500 twice a year. And, you know, as I move on with this, you know, I think it's important to note that Eric's really good about making sure everything is on that maintenance schedule and being inspected and so forth at the proper times, which is why our building looks the way it does. We'll be able to save a lot with landscaping that we've had Hewing to do in the past, because now John will be able to take over that. Lining up football field, snow removal, window cleaning things he talked about. It does not include bus maintenance and bus trips during the day. Then John would just, you know, if we got the pickle, he'd be able to just jump in a bus and be able to do that. That would just be part of his day. He wouldn't get paid extra for that. So, you know, what Eric had proposed with all of those different things could not be done locally by John, would actually end up saving the district around $15,000 a year, even by creating that position. So that was how we justified the creation of that position.
To me, that's the perfect way. This is what I want, and this is how I'm going to save the money up.
Right.
That's great. It's perfect.
Right. So he anticipated the savings to be $62,277.80. Down to the penny, and then of course you subtract the salary that we gave John, and that means what we actually ended up saving for the district. But it was, you know, he justified the position, I think, is what we were trying to say, and that's what you wanted me to point out, right? Okay.
And another reason for me is it is a scary thing to think of that only Eric would understand the systems in this building.
I know Eric can be on vacation, and you know what I mean, try to be out of town and can't because, yeah, you know, he gets calls, he goes, likes to go camping, but, you know, goes 2 hours away and then comes back like every day or something.
That's a good point.
And we need someone that understands all of those systems that can be a backup at any time.
Yeah, and John's finishing, he'll be finished, I think, he's got a class this summer, yeah, he's finished, but he hasn't, you know, the degree then and the knowledge to know how to do all that electrical programming and stuff and the computers and for the security system and for, I mean, just for everything in the building. He'll be like another little walker.
I really believe that.
Actually, he'll be a bigger one.
Yeah, well, that's true. I think it's doing it.
Yes. Okay, and then would you give a statement on the retirement stipend?
Yeah, we had a few months ago had created a offer to our staff because we were anticipating we were going to have a RIF. We were trying to avoid that by enticing someone to jump on this retirement stipend. And if you remember back, Andy had presented his rationale and on why we were going to do that. I just wanted to report that no one took that stipend, so there was no cost to the district at all. And as it turned out, our kindergarten numbers increased significantly enough that we didn't have to end up ripping anyone anyhow. So it all worked out perfectly in the end. But back when we were trying to make those decisions, we were faced with probably having to cut an employee, and we were trying to avoid that. It's kind of for fun to go through a riff.
And kind of like, you know, you and I had a conversation. To me, yeah, it didn't work out, but it was, I guess, the forward thinking of Mr. Hunter, you know, and I'm sure maybe he had some other people helping to say, hey, you know what, let's think outside the box. What can we do to save money? And to me, that was probably the biggest gain, to see staff getting involved in doing that. So appreciate that. Thank you.
Kudos.
Okay.
Any other old business?
Yes, I'd like to address one thing. Jake Turnbull called me a couple days ago. He was curious about the next board meeting. And I guess he was questioning the athletic Hall of Fame, and I guess just wanted to make sure we didn't kind of fall off the table. And so I didn't know, maybe in next board meeting, maybe we could have a little more discussion about some type of a Hall of Fame, whether it would include athletics, elastic, staff that have worked at the school, kind of, you know, I guess on a grander scale. But I guess it's just something I wanted to bring up to make sure it was still, I guess, thought about.
Whether or not, discussion item for next month.
Yeah, you know, can talk about some positives and negatives, and I guess if people are talking to the community, you know, out in the community, maybe get some thoughts and see what people think. Because it's not going to all be positive. I'm quite certain of that. Some people are going to be against it, and I think we just need to weigh all of those issues before we kind of move forward.
Okay, and
I have an item, because I don't remember if you told me what to do. If you did, I forgot. But I don't know if I even mentioned it in the last board meeting, but remember when Eric had the guy,
yes,
the demonstration on the glass? Did I tell you what that quote was?
$22,000.
Right. Did you tell me to go ahead with that or not go ahead with that? Or you didn't say anything, right?
I want to do it, but at the same time, I guess maybe that's one of the things we can look at, is say, okay, where can we save some money? Because to me, it is definitely worthwhile. I like the idea, but again, it's paying for it.
My thought on this would be, let's hold off for a little while. I met with a member of the community who has a company that he's investing in. I think we should wait,
sure,
and see how that pans out before we decide if we want to do this. So,
and I agree. I think if this is something we want to pursue, I would like to see what other companies out there had. Are there other options? You know, this was just one presented to us, and I would think that there are probably others. And let's see what best suits us and fits us for the long term financially.
The one that's being worked on now, potentially being proposed, I really can't really speak to it yet, but if that comes to fruition, there will be no cost to the district.
Right, and I don't want to go ahead with that and then have another project that supersedes it and gets rid of all that and replaces it with something else.
Okay.
So,
I agree that there's no sense in jumping, at first into it.
Okay, excellent. Thank you. That's all I have.
And I have one other thing for
Yes,
I'm sorry,
okay,
Steph.
Right,
please go ahead. I apologize.
Worry.
I meant to say something, but go ahead.
Yeah, probably not. The open house for the community.
September 9th.
I'm wondering, because we're doing a lot of really neat things here, if there is just, not even for sure, but just something that we can give to people as they come in and say, this is what's changed since the school was opened in 2010, this is how much more we're saving, this is how we can be more cost effective, so they can see that overall, we're trying really hard to do the best that we can to be responsible while still doing the best that we can to the community. Also,
I like that.
I do too.
To see if we had stations of kids, a couple kids there explaining the axle shape and what we did with that.
We had more hands of the
kids.
Winners.
Sure,
and
that would be really neat.
Kids, explaining what they do in Mr. Farrell's class, several stations of kids explaining some of the different.
It could be something with art. I mean, it's just have
some
nice stations.
Some of the awesome things that we do here. It's kind of like a science fair exhibit with
love it.
All about us.
Yeah, I will come in over the summer, yeah.
I do too.
I hope that, gosh, we failed that. And I'm hoping that we didn't make it too soon.
A lot of that you can probably get straight from Eric and some of the athletic things that have happened in the past too. I mean, we've done, the sports programs have done tremendously well in the past few years.
I just know how fast the summer goes. I mean, we're going to, next week, summer's going to be here and everybody's like, oh, thank God. And then all of a sudden it's like, September 1st!
Well, I think we need to use kids from this year. I mean, we don't want to do anything that's anything for next year. We can use kids that have done this year.
Right.
And use that. That'll take off some of the pressure for some, I mean, for getting ready for fall, because it's not going to be contingent on anything there.
And I'm sorry.
No, thank you. I guess I just want to make sure everybody realizes, because we talked about the financial meeting, was the $60,000 from the sale of the land we had discussed as a group, you know, maybe using part of that for fencing, for whatever out at, you know, baseball, football fields. And since we didn't have a plan yet, that's why it went into the operating budget. So come next year or whenever, that's where that $60,000 is sitting at right now. So I don't know if Steph and Jeff, if you guys had some plans on, I guess, what needs done the worst, and we kind of look down the list and say, okay, you know what, maybe we can put a couple check marks to fix a few things.
And I know we're talking about some of that stuff in our work session after too, so.
Okay.
What do you think, tell us what you think your top priority is when we get to that. Okay, anything else? I love your break, guys. Okay. June and July school board meetings. We had tentatively said last month that we would go to June 25th because of a couple conflicts those 2 weeks in between that we really can't meet.
And then not do it July.
Depends.
Okay. August 13th, that was a long time in the summer.
Huh?
Our next meeting, we skip the July meeting, we'd be going from June 25th to August 13th.
Right.
With probably a special meeting somewhere.
Maybe.
To do.
Sometimes we do need to, sometimes I do need to call a special meeting, but I think it's only happened once. So with the June 25th meeting, hopefully by then we'll have a guidance counselor to recommend.
Great.
And then hopefully we won't have to have a July one, but if we do,
so that works for everybody. For this time, June 25th, no July meeting. August 13th would be the August meeting. Works? Okay.
It would be adjusted, right?
Yes,
it
would be adjusted. Okay. Anything else that we need to do? Most of it, you know, or
not that I do.
Okay. Are there any unannounced guests that would like to speak to the board? I don't think so. Okay. I need to have a motion to go into executive session for item number one. Jen? Jerry? Okay, we'll hold an executive session between, let's say, 8 o'clock and 6 minutes. Whenever we're done, there will be no action taken at the conclusion of the executive session, but we will have a work session at the conclusion. Okay? Passed 5-0, we'll go into executive session at 8 o'clock.